All right, in the sanctified church, they started out with prayer, then they had testimonies, right? Is that right? Anybody remember how they have a testimony says?
Yeah.
Okay. Why do you think that they had testimony in service?
To encourage each other, lift each other up.
Lift each other up, that's right.
So that was a big deal. And one thing that happens when people testify consistently is that they get more bold at it.
Mm-hmm.
And, even the least person, shy person, mm-hmm. even the person that most shy, they always get up. At least they said, thank the Lord for being here.
Mm-hmm.
After being here, you find me what? Saved and sanctified. Hit with the Holy Ghost and that with fire. Pray for my strength in the Lord. And they would sing a song, or they would give some incident, or they would quote a scripture while they were doing it. And that's the thing that made them bold.
Amen.
And when they sing song, you could hear them. It wasn't solo. Solo, you can't hear. So I was thinking, I said, what can we do to get people to say anything in the congregation? Because if we would call on people at random to give a testimony or to say something or to exhort or to even give a scripture or whatever, every time they would have a drawback spirit. So I guess we are missing out on something we are not doing that cause people to get bold and practice making confessions that's consistent with what God is doing through their lives. So I've been thinking about how we can really begin to get people to, because sometimes people in the church, you've never heard them say anything. And that used to happen in the sanctified church. If you didn't testify, they think that what? You had backslidden. You lost your testimony. Sister Karen, y'all remember the church of God?
I do.
Brother Daniel, probably.
He didn't grow up in church, guys.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
But even people that weren't noted to have good voices, they testify and sing. And I think that's good. And, I know we can't turn the clock back, but we got to do something to let the voice of praise be heard. We got to do something. We got to come up with something. So this upcoming consecration, we want to focus on how we can get people, how we can get their voices heard, how we can get some kind of confession out of them, or how we can get them to affirm something that God is doing in their life or something that God has already done and what they want to become reality, concerning the things that God already has provided us. Okay, so tonight we're going to probably get at the root of the problems that we are confronted, because I don't like it, even in prayer meetings, when people don't say anything. I mean, they're quiet, but you don't hear them excited and blurting out confessions or shabakin and expressing their love and their, gratitude to God and being excited about what God has provided us and all of the redemptive works that God has done for us. And it's kind of, we don't want to be at a loss just to try to come up with something that God has done for us, because that is the key for any promise of God coming to pass. If you want God's promises to come to pass, you have to affirm what He has done, and you have to praise God before the manifestation comes. And so if that is the key if that's the key thing, the most important part of our walk with the Lord is affirming the things that He has done for us, and then turning around and what praising God for the fulfillment of it, praise God even before it happens. That's what we call offering the sacrifice of what? Thanksgiving.
So is that what you want us to do tonight?
Well, I want you to pull out the if y'all have this little handout that we had a couple of weeks ago, the righteousness of God. I don't know what you have. I got some extra comments.
I didn't bring that.
But we want to get at the reason why people don't do that. People don't do the mainest thing that God is required of them. And this is the thing that...
What little handout are you talking about?
Well, I give you so many that you don't know one from another. Okay. The righteousness of God, and it has in here... definition, what does righteousness really mean? And then it tells about all of the challenges that we have in life are due mainly to us not understanding who we are in Christ. If you don't have it, I charge the fine for this one.
I'd like to make a suggestion.
What?
Since you say we don't testify, mm-hmm. we don't do all that,
mm-hmm.
I would like to say, if you would, to take tonight, we've been hearing about the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus and everything, and I'd like to hear how this is working in some people's lives.
Okay, well, we're going to do that. We're going to do that.
But if you wait until 10 minutes before it's time, we don't have time to.
Well, we want to. I'll let you know. Okay. Okay, now, we want you to understand what righteousness really is and how the definitions that we have attached to it, page 27 in this little handout. If you don't have it,
I'll
come over and borrow one.
Nobody has it.
Yeah, if y'all haven't read it, we don't have nothing to talk about.
Yeah,
you just be talking off the top of your head. And that's not good. I want you to understand it. All right. Righteousness from this handout on page 27. In a generous sense, means receiving the life and nature of God, becoming united with God, a sense of oneness and fellowship with the Father, as the vine and the branch are all one, the head and the body are all one, the ocean and the bay are all one. And we have gathered here tonight under the banner of North South Christian Center, we all are what? One. Although we might be in bodies, but we have what? We are one entity.
Mm-hmm.
So we are one. So righteousness is the thing that unites us back to God. That was the thing that Jesus actually, that was the main objective of the redemptive work that was done through Christ, to connect us back to God, to unite us back to God. So when we are reconciled back to God, we receive His life, nature, and ability. We receive God's life, and that's the thing that enables us to come into the presence of God once again without a sense of fear or inferiority, without feeling second class, feeling unworthy, feeling like you are below par. Okay, so righteousness is probably the greatest revelation in the Bible, period, because from righteousness we get our reconciliation, we get our authority back in all things that were taken from us initially through Adam's disobedience. All of that is restored through righteousness. because we are in right standing. That's what actually righteousness means, right standing with God. Okay, under the old covenant, were people in right standing with God? Yes or no? Okay, y'all want to talk? Yes or no? Under the old covenant, were people in right standing with God? Were there any that were in right standing with God? Okay, under the old covenant, those that expressed faith in Christ, Israel, those heroes of faith, those old patriarchs and prophets that walked with God, they did have a limited righteousness, a servant's righteousness. It was a righteousness that were reckoned to them on the basis of their faith in those blood, those animal sacrifices which represented Christ to come. It was based on the covenant that God made with them. You know, the covenant of the Old Testament was a strong covenant that gave them many rights and privileges and blessings and even enabled them to enter into the presence of God. I mean, when they came to the tabernacle, they were what? They came to worship. They had to offer what? Sacrifices in order for them to be able to come into the presence of God to worship. And also, whenever they sinned against God or sinned against their neighbor, they had to offer sacrifices. They had to offer fellowship sacrifices, and they had to offer sin sacrifices, trespass or sin offerings. That was the thing that enabled them to fellowship with God on a limited basis. It was not an unlimited righteousness that we have today. We call the righteousness that we have, we call that the righteousness, unlimited righteousness. We're called sons, whereas they were called what? Servants. So our their righteousness was based on the value that God placed on the blood of those animals and animal sacrifices, and also on it was based on their obedience to God. If they obeyed the terms of the covenant and did all that God required of them in terms of the commandments that that they were told to observe, then they were covered. What I mean by covered, C-O-V-E-R-E-D, their sins were covered. You know, once per year, they would have this big atonement. The high priest would offer up sacrifices for all of their sins. So that covered everything that they had done. If they had done a million, a thousand sins, then that covered it what? All. You know, sometimes, when we begin to enumerate our sins, you know, it's good that we don't have to go back in order to get remission. We have to remember every sin and enumerate and ask God to forgive us of every sin, because it would be a whole lot that we would forget. It would be a whole lot that we wouldn't call sin, but remission does it all. It covers it all. But under the old covenant, did they have remission?
No.
Okay, what did they have under the old covenant?
Sacrifices
actually what covered their sin. In other words, it kept the wrath of God from what falling on them, and they still would be able to enjoy the rights and privileges and the blessings if they adhered to that. And when they got off, they had to get back in fellowship, you know, by offering those sacrifices and so forth and so on. Okay, now, if those sins, all of those sins they committed under the old covenant were not forgiven or not remitted, when did they actually get remitted? Because in order to have the righteousness of God, I mean, the nature of God, the life of God imputed to you, or either receiving the life and nature of God, then you have to, amen, have your sins remitted. And you have to have a mediator. And that didn't happen until Christ came and acted as our mediator to bring us to God. So what happened to the Old Testament saints' sins, the old patriarchs and prophets' sins? What happened to them?
What happened to them?
I mean, how did they have, are God still holding those against them?
No. And Jesus paid, his atonement was a complete atonement for all of creation.
All right. The atonement that Jesus made was retroactive. He went back and covered all of the sins of what? Israel. All of them that died in faith, that had professed faith in Christ, and the sacrificial system which represented the antitype, that was a type of Christ. Christ was the actual antitype. But when Christ atoned for sins, all of those sins were wiped out. And all of them that were in paradise were released from paradise. And then they went to the new paradise, which is in heaven now. So they weren't permitted to go to heaven until, I mean, in the presence of God, until all of their sins were remitted. And that's the beautiful part of our righteousness today. Righteousness enabled you to actually reconnect with God in terms of actually approaching him, not through a sacrificial system, not through the priest, but you can approach him what? Directly. And Christ, you know, introduces us to God. Our sins are remitted. The old nature is what? Driven out. And we become a what? A new creation. We have the life and the nature of God. Is that good? Is that good? Amen. So it's right standing with God, but we can see the price that Jesus paid was a price that covered what all of our what sins. Okay, anybody want to talk about that? So we want to talk, but we want to know what we're talking about, not just running off. All right, so under the old covenant, they did have an approach to God. It was through what? Blood sacrifices, through what?
Rituals
and dreams and visions and the voice of an angel. All of these things were ways that God spoke and men were able to approach God. But were they able to operate in that dominion that Adam had initially? Okay, that authority that God initially gave to man. Were the Old Testament patriarchs and prophets, were they able to operate in that dominion to a certain extent?
To a certain extent. To a degree. But not on their own accord. They had to, the timing had to be by God, the approach, the initiation of it, all of it had to be through something that God constructed for them to obey and do before they could operate and take authority and so forth. Now Joshua, he did some outstanding things, but he still had to go through the correct approach and steps, if you will, because he couldn't just decree like we can today.
Right. Okay. Well, that's good. Now, another time I want you to talk, but we want to kind of keep it in the context of what we're trying to get over. Everybody can give a. I'll let y'all give y'all testimonials and all that. But Brother William was saying that it was a limited righteousness. It was a limited righteousness that they offered. It wasn't an unlimited because Christ, the Spirit of God was not living and abiding in them as he is permitted to do today, he's able to do today. See, today, the Spirit of God abides with us always, 24-7. Is that right? Round the clock? Okay, on the Old Testament and prophets that were gifts of God, the Holy Spirit came on them. And they prophesied, they did all of the gifts were in operation except what? Tongues and interpretation. So that's the power of God that was what? Working on them. But the Spirit of God was moving on them, and the Spirit of God did not remain in them, and they did not have the Spirit of God to the extent that we have them today. But the thing that enabled God to have that close fellowship with them was the fact of their obedience to the covenant, you know, the blood covenant. There were certain things that they had to do in order for God's presence to what? To be with them. And God's presence, y'all know, was with David and with Joshua and all of these great men of God. And they did exercise that dominion that was given to Adam, because I don't know if anybody, I mean, talking about Moses, I mean, all of the things that he did, you know, that's kind of hard to match even today with our unlimited rights and privileges. We have an unlimited righteousness now. Can y'all know anybody operate like Moses?
Well,
you know, the prodigies that he accomplished, the things that he accomplished. How many? Okay, now Joshua, y'all know that he, God told him to, after Moses died, he went over, he told him to go over the Jordan, and told him to send the priests over, and when they touched the brink of the water, that the water will look back up just like it did for Moses. Well, that's some supernatural stuff. Is that right? And then also we know that, you know, all of those promises that God had made them in terms of inheriting the land, we know all of those things came to pass, and all of those cities fell remarkable. I mean, it was miraculous. Jericho, it started with Jericho. The walls of Jericho fall. And all of those cities that God had promised Israel, you know, when those spies went over, and the only two faithful to them were who? Caleb and who? Joshua. And why were they so bold in making those confessions that, you know, fear not, God has given us the land, they're going to be what? Food for us. Don't back down. Don't let fear over, fear not, you know, don't let fear overtake you, because God has given us the land. We are well able to what? To possess the land. Why were they so bold? See, that was righteousness, because righteousness also, now, don't get mad at me now, because I'm not letting y'all talk right now. But righteousness is boldness. Now now this is what we're speaking about now, boldness and confidence. Okay, on page 27 in your little handout. Okay, righteousness in a general sense means receiving the life and nature of God, becoming united with God, a sense of oneness and fellowship with the Father. And that is what happened under the Old Covenant, when there was a oneness and fellowship between the man of God and the Father, when they cut covenant together. They came in a blood covenant relationship. God promised to what? To be with them, and to provide, sustain, and protect them. All of those Jehovah's represent that God had completely committed to what? Take care, to back them up, and they were under supernatural what? Guidance, protection, provisions, everything that they ever needed, God had pledged under that blood covenant to what? To be that to them. So they were in a close fellowship relationship. Everybody agree with that? And that's what it is. If you're united with God, God is going to what? Back you up. But there was what? There were those, the obedience factor was something that everything was contingent upon what? Their obedience to the terms of the covenant. And y'all know the covenant. God said, thou shalt do this, thou shalt not do this. And look at Deuteronomy. It's a whole lot of things. Even on healing, God said, if you would what? Keep all of my statutes, walk in all my ways, and do all of this and do all of that, then a sickness won't come nigh you. And if you do get sick, then God will what? Take it away. He will take it from the midst of you. Those were the covenant rights that they had under the old covenant. And they really worked, because Israel walked in the light of the covenant of healing for 465 years and was straight. Nobody ever, you know, went to a doctor. Well, there were no doctors, no medicine, no hospitals, no nothing. Just the word of God, I am the Lord that will heal it thee. But they had a list of things that God required of them, and if they didn't do it, and they disobeyed, then they had to what? They had to get it. I don't think anybody was perfect those 465 years, just like we ain't perfect today. But when they got out of land, they got back through what?
The prescribed way.
That's how God handled it under the old covenant. And that's good. That's how God handles it today. Ain't none of us going to be able to walk in every detail of God's command every day, week, and month. But that's the reason why Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. And he's what? Committed to being our what? Mediator. Not only our mediator, but our what? Our advocate. And he, when we get out of land, the Bible says that he's our what, advocate, and we are to what? To go and to what? Get it back straight. Is that good? Got nothing to shout about?
Yep.
The present day ministry of Christ, is enough to shout about? Is that enough to shout about?
Yes.
Okay, let's talk about that, if y'all want to talk. Let's talk about it.
Talking about
a testimony. Well, testimony is, you know, all of the benefits and blessings that God has bestowed on us. And we got tons of them in the Bible. You know, Paul, you know, gave us a clue. He says that if any man be in Christ, I'm a new. That's a testimony there. Mm-hmm. That's the first thing I learned when I got saved. Any man be in Christ, I knew that for sure because I had experienced it. He becomes a what? New creature. All things pass away. And all things become new. Okay, let's look at the definition again. A sense of receiving the life and nature of God, but that's for the sons of God. That's not the servants under the old covenant. They didn't receive the life and nature of God, but they did have a way that they could approach God and experience God's fellowship. A sense of oneness and fellowship with the Father. All right. Number two, righteousness in a specific sense is the ability to live and function as a believer without a sense of sin, guilt, fear, or inferiority. That's in a whole lot. To state it another way, the ability to come into and live in God's presence with the same freedom and liberty as Jesus in his earthly walk, or having the same freedom and liberty as a child who approaches his earthly father. So righteousness gives us boldness in God's presence. Okay, why should we have boldness in God's presence? Why should we be bold and confident when we come into God's presence? You know, he said, come boldly before the what? The throne to receive what? Mercy and grace to help us in the time of what need. Why is it that, you know, someone said this, and I believe it's true, the Bible even backs me up on this, that when a person understands the righteousness, they're standing with God and that they are the righteousness of God, and they're able to come into God's presence without a sense of sin, inferiority, and also they're able to come into Satan's presence without feeling what? Inferior, mm-hmm. even to him. Okay, why does that make you a conqueror? Why does that give you, let me see, it makes you more than a conqueror? The ability to come in God's presence and even into Satan's presence without fear, without feeling inferior, why does that make you a master? Master over evil. Master over Satan. Why does that make you a master when you're able to come into God's presence without a sense of sin or inferiority?
Because you know who you are in Christ and
you're here to honest with you. All right, that's good. Now, we can talk on that. Say that again, Sister Denise.
One knows who he is in Christ and he knows who the Father is to him.
All right, that's good. Okay, anybody else?
Well, under the old covenant, you had to be, you couldn't go before God on your own. You couldn't go and plead your case. You couldn't go in the tabernacle because you couldn't get fired up. You just couldn't walk in there. You know, you had to be represented by the priest, something like that. But under this covenant, you can do it on your own. You don't need anyone to go with you or go to God. You can go to God directly for yourself. You know, so that gives you a much better covenant, you know, than the old one.
Okay.
You know, God gives you the opportunity and ability to stand before him, to plead your case.
All right.
For yourself.
All right, that's good. All right. Anybody else got anything to offer? Bradley, you got something. I don't have it. Right. Now, we're talking about being bold and confident and being able to testify or say something in the congregation.
I remember, I was trying to look at that scripture where Job said, if I could only have a daysman looking for somebody to go in between me and God, I could argue my case. I forgot what he called it. I thought it was a daysman or something like that. But he meant a referee or umpire. If I could have, that was his problem, is that, you know, all this is coming against me. I can't argue, but he says, if I had someone that would go up with me, a referee between me and God. Mm-hmm. And that's what he was looking for. He was looking for some approach to state his case and be there. Because that time he thought he was, I ain't done nothing wrong. You know, I need somebody to argue with me.
All right, an umpire or a mediator, someone that can put one hand on mankind and the other hand on God and bring them together. Mm-hmm. That was Job's argument. He just, okay, how can a man become righteous before God? That's what the question that he was asking. Mm-hmm. Now, to the question that I'm asking now, I'll let y'all talk about why we have so much, why many times people are reluctant or they fear standing or even expressing their faith in Christ openly or publicly. Why is it difficult to get people to get up and affirm things openly? As we mentioned, testify. Why is it? I know some denominations, I guess they've overcome their fear because they have actually acted on the word in that particular area. They overcame it, I guess, by doing it over and over and over. I remember the first time I got saved, and I never dreamed that I could get up and talk before people because I was very bashful. I just never testified or anything. And the first thing I did when I got saved and filled with the Holy Spirit, after rolling on the floor, you know, they call us holy rollers way back then, about 2 or 3 hours rolling on the floor and praying in tongues. When I got up, well, I was really bold. Now, something came on the inside of me. Man, I was glad to get up. And so if any man be in Christ, my God, he's a new creature. Whole things pass away and all things. I experienced that. So that testimonial was really real to me that day. And I wasn't reluctant to get up. There was a lot of boldness. I guess that righteous nature enabled me to boldly stand up and make that confession. But the reason why I was asking that question is because the scripture says, whosoever is born of God turn to that scripture, 1 John 5:4, is that right? Whosoever is born of God overcometh the world. This is the victory of the Lord, overcometh the world, what? Even our faith. And not only do you overcome the world, but you overcome what? Satan, sin, and all of the works of what? Satan. So being born of God, having the life of God, and the ability and the strength of God, all of that comes in the moment we become the righteousness of God, the moment we receive Christ. And that's the thing that makes you what? An overcomer. And that's the thing that makes you a victor. That's the thing that Paul talks about, me and all of the things that we have to confront, even including Satan. We are more than what? Conquerors through him that loved us. So the moment you become born of God and you receive the righteousness of God, the life and the nature of God, then actually you receive God's ability. It makes you a master. It makes you a master. Now, this is the... You know, just by that scripture, whosoever was born of God. Is that, anybody find that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, read it again. What does it say?
Whosoever is born of God,
mm-hmm,
overcometh the world.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the victory that overcometh the world, mm-hmm, even our faith.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so the victory that overcomes the world. You know, how many would agree that we are devil masters when we are born of God, when we become the righteousness of God? We are devil masters.
Yes.
Masters of all evil and all forces of darkness. And the question is, why does not that register? The question is, why doesn't that register with believers? Maybe that would be a good question that we can talk about.
Why doesn't it register with believers?
Okay, okay.
Because we don't.
We don't well,
often we don't practice that. We may believe it at some level, but when the challenge is produced, often it's not realized because you don't practice what you know. You don't do what you know to do.
All right.
One doesn't do what he knows.
All right. Y'all read it from the we got it from the horse's mouth, from the Bible, straight from God. Whosoever was born of God, what? Overcoming the world, for this is the what?
Victory.
Okay, the victory. This is the victory. In other words, we reconcile back to God. We're plugged into God, into all of his ability. We got the authority back, right? That was the thing that Satan took from us that left us what? Hopeless.
Mm-hmm.
And then all of the rights and privileges came back too. Now, why aren't we masters? Why don't we act and talk and respond and testify and affirm things like we are masters? But, you know, we need to adjust that. We need to talk about that.
Sometimes people are still acting in fear, and the renewing of your mind changes that over a period of time, but you have to do something for it to change.
Mm-hmm.
And that means getting in your word, mm-hmm, and sometimes falling on your face,
mm-hmm,
and making mistakes, mm-hmm, and growing from them, from your experiences,
mm-hmm,
and continue to know that God is going to help you and the Holy Spirit will guide and lead you.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah.
All right, Sister Irene, you preach it.
Yeah, I fell on my face last night, so.
All right,
you want
to
prayer class.
I'm saying the devil talks us out of it just like he taught people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yeah.
We let him deceive us.
That's right.
And he tells us a lie and what have you, and we won't act, or we won't confess, we won't do whatever is necessary,
right,
because
mm-hmm,
He comes and he starts lying to us, mm-hmm, creating doubt. And instead of us depending on what God's word is saying,
mm-hmm,
we listen to that other, whatever it may be,
mm-hmm,
another source, another sound,
mm-hmm,
and we pretty much will go by that because we start looking at I'm just limited.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
I'm only self-educated.
Mm-hmm. Our natural abilities.
Yeah, so looking within, this is all I got.
Mm-hmm.
But when this is the victory overcomes the world. Anything, any challenge you have in the world, mm-hmm. your faith can give you the victory over mm-hmm. it.
Amen.
But if the devil starts talking to you strong enough, we probably just
back up, back down.
Back down.
Back down.
All right, now here's y'all time to jump in. Got a young man over here.
Sister Shirley.
Okay, Sister Shirley.
And you know, sometime about this testifying, sometimes when people testify, other people say, oh, they say that over and over. Same old testimony. I don't think people should do that.
You're right.
And you know, that throws a block at people where they don't want to get up and testify. Right. And I don't think that's right.
Criticism.
Yeah, criticism.
They criticize the testimony?
Yeah.
I've heard people.
Oh, girl, he did the same testimony.
Right.
I think that's wrong.
I just
don't think it's right.
Well, in the Holiness Church, we always knew what people were going to say. Thank the Lord for being here. After being here, you find me saved and sanctified. Filled with the Holy Ghost and fire. And pray for my strength in the Lord every time. You know, I can understand that.
Yeah.
Why
yeah.
people would rag you by, you know, saying the same thing.
Yeah.
But you gotta, all of these promises in God, you could sell 10,000, I mean, get up and sell a new scripture. Some scripture experience that you had. Either some people just got up and said, the Lord is the light, is my light and my salvation. Mm-hmm. Every time they would get up and they would quote a scripture before they would say anything.
Mm-hmm.
So what's wrong with that? You could have a new scripture every time. You could get by with it a few times without them start laboring you.
Sometimes these things don't become alive to us.
Yeah.
Like Joshua and Caleb and the spies.
Mm-hmm.
All of them went up.
Mm-hmm.
They all saw the same thing,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Two came back with a good report.
Mm-hmm.
The others with an evil report.
Mm-hmm.
Now then, the ones with the evil report, it wasn't that they didn't see what they saw.
Mm-hmm.
They reported what they saw.
Mm-hmm.
And often that's what we focus on, what we see, what we see and what we feel,
mm-hmm.
as opposed to what the Word says.
Mm-hmm.
It was those two that said we are well able to take it. Let's go up and possess it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. They believe the Word and they just believe in God. They saw the same thing the others saw,
mm-hmm.
but they had a different disposition.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes that's what we do.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not that, and you know, when you hear people say, well, don't look at the negative, you're being negative. No, they saw it. They all saw the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
But.
Well, actually, they didn't all see the same thing.
Well, they did
okay,
see
what I mean.
It.
In their mind, well,
in their mind, but naturally,
the eye of faith.
No. The eye of faith, they didn't. But
mm-hmm.
in their mind, that
mm-hmm.
through their visual is what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Their natural eye, they saw the grapes. All those other grapes that took all this to carry them. They saw it.
But well, they saw different capabilities.
That's it. They saw different capabilities, and that's why there was a different report.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, let me ask you this: since you brought that up, when Caleb said. The day that they went up to spy the land,
mm-hmm.
the land, he said, the word of God was in my heart. Eventually when they had conquered the nations and actually Joshua had divided the land,
mm-hmm.
and he asked for his mountain,
mm-hmm.
because God had promised him to
right.
do it. Now, whatever piece of land you tried on, that's going to be given to you as a
mountain. Mm-hmm.
He said that, you know, he was 85 then, and when he went over to spy, he was only what, 40. On the day that he went over, and I mean 85, he said, I'm just as strong now as I were when I was 40.
So now, what's your question?
And he said that the Word of God, in that day, the reason why we were able to make that bold statement, the Word of God was in my heart. It was burning in my heart.
Exactly.
And it was based on what God had promised Israel years ago as an inheritance, and the time of that prophecy had come to the time for its fulfillment.
Based on what God had promised?
Based on, in Genesis.
Exactly.
Spoke to Abraham.
Did he not promise the others that went up the same thing? He promised them the same thing.
Well,
they just didn't.
Well,
they saw it differently.
Caleb and Joshua were men of the Holy Father God.
Exactly. Sure. So yeah. But the promise of God was the same. They just didn't. They viewed the promise differently.
Yeah.
And what they saw with their natural eyes is often back to the question you had initially: is why don't sometimes we
walk in our righteousness?
Right. Mm-hmm. Because we. You see those things naturally, and you know what the Word of God says, but you have to stand firm on what the Word says. Otherwise, you're going to start looking at those circumstances.
Okay. You're going to, boldness and confidence. Boldness and confidence that the Word produced in them was the reason why they were so firm.
Right.
And they knew beyond a doubt that the land was theirs, and they would stand for them to.
So that's the difference.
The Word produced faith in them.
Yeah, the Word produced faith.
And God whereas told, with God the told, others, yeah. it obviously it, didn't. No, to the agree, to the degree that they would say, let's sure, we can do it.
Yeah,
it, it didn't produce that in them.
Yeah, I imagine it's just like everybody in here and everybody in the church. We be preaching whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. It just means something different to everybody.
Sure,
something different. Because people say, well, that is for people like Pastor Hill. That's not for me. And a lot of times they still don't really believe that they are fully delivered anyway. Mm-hmm. Although all of these scriptures that affirm that we are what? That old things are passed away, we're fully delivered, we're fully accepted. God doesn't hold anything against us. You know, who can lay anything against God's elect? I mean, you have all of those scriptures. Expressing God is for us are tons of scriptures, but yet people feel that God is not for them because of that sin, that
sin consciousness,
yes. And they're still suffering with that problem, and that truth that we have here does not get through.
So then, the question is, struggling with the same consciousness, what does one do to overcome that? That's it. Get in the Word. Get in the Word and stay in it, and then operate in what is like James 1:22, be ye doers of the Word and not hearers only, deceiving your own self. So I think oftentimes we hear it, we hear it, but when it comes to doing it,
What is man's challenge? Is it the challenge to operate in faith or to recognize his righteousness, recognize his nature?
What is his challenge?
Yeah, is it do I not have enough faith or do I not know what my nature is? Because once you have the nature of Adam and you realize that, faith wouldn't be too much of a producing faith. The extraordinary or doing something great won't be the challenge, because Adam did stuff all the time until he was found in sin. And what God did for Abraham, he was trying to get Abraham to walk in faith, but what did he take Abraham? Abraham had to prove that he was right with God before he could even think about walking in faith.
Right.
Same thing on the New Testament side. What is he trying to get over to us? To get us to walk in faith. Realize what Christ has done for you.
Right, that's good. That's good. And the first thing we can do is get up and say, the Lord is the strength of my life. Y'all pray for me. I mean, anything that affirms, anything that can affirm something that Christ has done, you got to start with that. Boldly. Not scared. What people are going to say? I wonder if I'm completely saved. You know, these bad experiences, you know, I ain't like that. Right next to the knees. You know, I don't know whether this worked for me. Most people are scared to say anything as to what God has done for them openly.
Yeah, that's true.
And I'm a pastor here, and I'm here. I know what goes on here. And I want to know, why is it like that? Some people never say anything.
One affects the folks, for example, she said one affects the other.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Automatically.
Intertwined.
So, yeah.
I think I better know my righteousness first.
How can you walk in faith if you don't know your righteousness?
Yeah. Do I have to know it from a mental standpoint, or do you have to know it in?
In your heart. You got to know it in your heart.
Okay, brother Jared over here, if I don't call up, he ain't going to say a word. I was impressed what he told me last week. He has emerged as, you know, in his family, that he's the barrier of the truth to a great extent. In other words, he's looked up now as a spiritual leader. He's emerged.
Amen.
And what he has received, he's very bold in it. And maybe he can articulate a little something.
You're putting him on the spot.
Yeah, I just spot, okay, well.
Speak when the time's right. Mm-hmm. I just speak when the time is right.
You speak to who now?
Mm-hmm. No, I just speak when the time is right.
Mm-hmm. To your family or in here?
Oh, wait. In general.
In general.
Mm-hmm. Family, friends, it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Have anybody got any results from whatever you've spoken to?
It's getting there. Mm-hmm. It's a good one. One for sure.
Who's that?
I had an older sister. Mm-hmm. And she finally got saved, so.
Praise God. Amen.
Prayer and the way I approach certain situations. You know, approach certain situations are different. Mm-hmm. I don't approach everybody in the same way.
That's right. Mm-hmm. That's right. Mm-hmm. That's
pretty much.
That's good.
Let's do it.
Yeah. Okay. All right, let's keep on talking. Y'all can get it out. Y'all wanted to talk.
I see some people are trapped between both covenants. Mm. No, their heart is operating in the covenant that we have today, but their minds are still back in the old covenant, you know, where they still have that disconnect with God. Until they see something, they don't believe it's going to happen. But in their heart, they know the covenant that we have today with Jesus. They know who Jesus is. Mm-hmm. They know that he died for our sins, that he freed us up. Mm-hmm. You know, they know a lot of that. But that's in their hearts. But in their minds, they're still operating under that old covenant. Mm-hmm. Because their faith is not grown or not established enough, where their mind is in line with their heart. Mm-hmm. You know, their heart leans and claims and desire one thing, but their mind is not sure if that's what the heart really wants. Mm-hmm. Until the mind is lined up with the heart, they're going to be in that.
Well, you know, sometimes the mind may not ever line up with the heart. You know, when you think about spirit, body, and soul, sometimes the mind is not going to ever, sometimes it's not going to agree with the heart. It depends on what it is you're trying to get accomplished. But sometimes your mind, just like for, you heard about a young lady lifting a car in an accident off of her father. Well, did her mind, did she have to get her mind to get her body to agree, get everything together and say, we're going to get this done?
Automatic.
And sometimes some things that the mind just won't agree with. That might be why we have to pray in the spirit, because your mind just ain't going to agree. I mean, common sense, knowledge, I need a miracle. And it's just in the natural, it's not in that order. Mm-hmm. But sometimes your heart takes it deeper than what your mind can take you. And you don't worry about your mind, because it'll never catch up.
Right.
You know, sometimes, not all the time. Sometimes you get them all working together. Mm-hmm.
That's so good. I'm going to use a term that...
Mental
So you're talking about
homogenous. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay, let me ask this.
He's on my side.
Let me ask this question in a different way. What seems to limit us in the exercising of our righteousness? What holds us back? We know all of these things. I don't know whether we know them mentally or whether we know them, you know, in reality. We know who we are in Christ. We know that we have the life and nature and ability of God. We know that whosoever is born of God overcomes the world. The victor that overcomes is our faith. We know that God has given us power and authority over all power of the enemy. We know that we are called to go and use that authority and power and ability to rescue people, to bless them, to break the power of sin and Satan and sickness off of people. We know all of these facts above, but yet we seem like we still are locked in a state of uselessness. In other words, we know all of that, but we just won't use what we have to actually go and do the work that Jesus told us to do. Mm-hmm. Sister Irene mentioned that she feels like it's unrenewed man. Unrenewed man can be broken down and mean a whole lot of things. I guess fear probably would be included in.
Yeah, I think it's the answer is in number two.
Okay.
Sin, guilt, fear.
Okay.
Inferiority.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so okay, sin.
Sin, guilt, fear, and inferiority.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And well, how do you get beyond inferiority and fear and what else?
Guilt and sin.
Guilt.
Sin consciousness. How do you get beyond that? It's what we're trying to do. Consecration is coming up, you know. If we have the wrong mindset, we don't, you know, we limit God too much, and then going to consecration, and we, you know, our minds are not open. I know the consecration should help open our minds, but we need to get a few things settled just through discussion like we're doing right here. Amen. That can give you a lot of motivation, because of consecration, you could cover a wide range of territory and the word will become alive and a living thing. So you want to try to open yourselves up and understand how important it is for you to be open to the truth. Truth received can change whatever facts that exist in your life or circumstances. Truth is really important. Okay, so what can we do to overcome the timidity that we have? We're, you know, timid, we're fearful of saying things. Bible said, let them that seek me shout for joy. Let them say continually, the Lord be what? Magnify. We're supposed to be doing some astounding stuff in terms of praising God for all of these blessings and provisions that we have. But yet we cow down.
Yes, yeah. Mm-hmm. I want to, I guess, make a statement and ask the question at the same time.
Okay.
A lot of it, I think, is ignorance, meaning we don't know any better.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really hard for you to say that here, mm-hmm, because we've been given so much information.
Mm-hmm.
But also, in some of these areas, it depends on where you are. Mm-hmm. Because some people are more enlightened, and in some areas they like, they got it together, they, mm-hmm, it's going on for them, and they see it in the spiritual as well as the natural, that God is working out, it's evolving, mm-hmm, and then they dormant or dead in, mm-hmm, other areas, mm-hmm, of their life.
Mm-hmm.
That's true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's good.
So then what do you do?
Mm-hmm.
Because the one, you know it's working, but you keep saying, but Lord, it's not working, it's not jabbing, I know that's what the word said, I know. Then what do you do?
Okay. Well, I heard a statement that this might share some light on everything. They said that they applied it to sickness, and they said that sickness is not due most times to a personal sin that we have done, or, you know, living in the habitual sins that we commit. But most of the sickness is attributed to laziness of spirit, laziness of soul. In other words, we don't apply our mental faculties enough, they're not active enough. And also spiritual activity, things like confessing the word or praying in the spirit or sharing the word with others. In other words, there's a lot sickness occurred. I mean, well, this is not only sickness, but any adversity, anything that we experience, it could be poverty. It could be the poverty mentality, because many times we don't mention that many times people have a poverty mentality. They feel inferior, bad because of their financial status. And they maybe don't have the education or the job, the training, and the support. And there's no, and looking in the future, they don't see any way where that can ever, you know, come together for them. So they feel defeated in the area of their finances. They just feel like they are kind of locked in to that, you know, that level of financial, you know, condition that they have. But it seems like spiritual authorities say that most of our limitations are due to laziness of soul. We just don't apply ourselves to the Word of God, and we don't do spiritual activities that's necessary in order for us to bring to pass the promises of God and to make things work for us in reality. Those are the things that we are slow to doing. In other words, like praying in the Spirit, reading scriptures, or affirming scriptures on a consistent basis. You know, see, all of these areas that God has provided us through the redemptive, His redemptive plan, we have to acknowledge all of these things if you want to enjoy the benefit of them. Just like you got saved through what? Confession. Just like, okay, the next thing that you confront that you need God to manifest, it has to also come the same way. And your life is going to be a life of continual confession. All right. So, as Sister Irene was saying, the renewing of the mind is going to be a step in the direction where you're going to enrich your spirit to the point you're going to energize your spirit, you're going to reprogram your spirit by helping people, ministering to people. See, life is the thing that's necessary in order for God to bring about His will anyway. He came that we might have what? Life, and life more abundantly. Everything happens through the life or the energy, the spiritual energy that you have on the inside. And that's the thing also that brings, you know, the promises of God to pass. So whatever you do to produce that spiritual energy necessary for God's power to be what manifested or to work through you, that's the thing that is going to be required for you to renew your mind. You're going to have to help people, bless people. If you really want to be alive, if you really want these scriptures and things to register what God has done for you, to register with you, you're going to have to be what? Helping somebody and feeding them and sharing them and what? Blessing them with what? Something. Well, y'all may not be ready to receive that, but praying in the Spirit. You know, Brother Skill was saying that he teaches people to pray in the Spirit 30 minutes every day. And I heard that.
And I said, well, still defeated.
Yeah.
No, I'm saying that. I'm saying that.
That's not all. I know people pray in the Spirit and that.
I said some are still defeated.
Mm-hmm. Well, because some.
You know what I think? I'm listening to very good discussion. Mm-hmm. Okay, we come week in and week out. Mm-hmm. Wednesday night. Mm-hmm. We learn the word. We hear the word. We hear the scriptures. We're learning. But I submit to you that this is partial learning. When we get the scriptures, mm-hmm. Now hear me good. This is not a schism, or I'm not being sacrilegious. I think real learning takes place in the school of, not Bible school, we need that, but the school of hard knocks.
That's when real learning takes place. Mm-hmm. When we're able to integrate what we have extracted from the word, and when that word has been internalized in us, and when we go out on a daily basis and we encounter those situations, various situations, that's what I say. We really learn in the school of hard knocks.
Okay.
We learn to an extent.
Why do you call here it hard knocks?
Well, yeah, because
she called hard knocks.
That's what it is, Brother William.
Irene said she failed yesterday.
School of hard knocks.
She stumbled or something, but she got hooked up with this sister. I said to her, you went back to that room and
you said which one?
You mentioned
I called her today too.
Okay. That's going to be hard knocks too. I mean, that's going to be something.
That's what I'm talking about.
I mean, that's going to be an experience that will really get your attention and will cause you to become alive.
Yeah, that's part
if you follow through with things like, if you're really diligent with that.
Yeah.
That's work. Is that Sister Denise? Is that work?
What? But it's fulfilling, though.
Can you call
yes.
me? And I pray that this one continues to come.
Oh, okay. The school of activity?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's still hard enough. As you say, grunt work.
Yeah, you the grunt work.
It gets very discouraging. Very discouraging.
Yeah.
You get very discouraged because people are going to act like people.
Yeah.
And their minds are not renewed. No. And they're dealing with a whole lot of generational stuff, right, that Brother Trevor? He's an expert on that generational stuff. He'll tell you all about it. And he'll give you that generational curse confession in a minute. But a lot of things in the past is the reason why we are where we are now.
Mm-hmm.
And if we want to reverse it, we're going to have to get some experiences that will, what, turn things around. And I don't know if any experience better than working with people. I mean, that's what Jesus has designed for us to be perfected anyway.
That's right.
Loving people, you know, as I have loved you, what? So you love one another just like I love you.
That's
right.
The word says, love
casteth out fear. That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Say that again.
Love casteth out fear.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
Woo!
Mm-hmm.
Perfect love.
You can vote for Bernie. Get your college. Send your kids to school.
No.
Well, I guess our time is
social. Yes. Yeah.
Not over. But. Let me tell you.
You want these back? No, I'm not giving it back. Those
scriptures.
I got one. I don't have one.
So sure.
You don't have one.
You don't have one thing else.
All right. If you went through that, you can see how righteousness causes us to reign as little kings in this life. If you want to reign, righteousness means that you are right standing with God. That means right living and right actions. Can't emphasize the right actions on the love that you have to walk, because that's how God wants us to be perfected. Faith with works by what? Love. If you want your faith to be perfected, you gotta what? You gotta love. And God tells us to increase more and more in terms of reaching out and blessing and helping people, because that's how you become alive, and that's how we get a whole lot of the spiritual hindrances broken from over our lives. So in our consecration next week, we want to really begin to focus on getting boldness.
It's burning.
Everybody has
to. I have an announcement.
All right. Let's leave this campaign. Father, we thank you for your grace. Your grace is sufficient. You're able, Father, to give us the measure of grace that's needed in order for us to overcome and to excel and to take our place in the kingdom of God. Amen. As a champion, Lord, we are masters. We have overcome the world, and the life of God is in us, and we have been given power and authority. The works that Jesus did, he has said that we are to do the same works and greater works than these. Father, we thank you that there's no way that we can do this, begin to do this, unless we are conscious of who we are. We have to realize that we have that dominion, that righteousness is a reality. Just as Moses approached God and told God that he couldn't destroy the righteous with the wicked, that boldness and confidence that he approached God with, the confidence and boldness that Joshua had when he was in battle and the battle hadn't been won. He spoke to the sun and the moon and told the sun and the moon to stand still until they avenge themselves of all of their enemies. Father, this type of righteousness we have seen, amen, by men who had only a servant's righteousness, a limited righteousness under the old covenant. But how much more, Father, under an unlimited righteousness, and being the sons of God, you say, as many as receive him, to them you have given the authority to become the sons of God. Lord, under our righteousness, which is unlimited, we can get a picture of how it's supposed to work just by looking at the life of Jesus. And the reason why Jesus was manifested in the flesh, he wanted us to see exactly how that dominion and how walking in righteousness actually is supposed to be manifested through us that belongs to the new creation. Father, help us to behold Jesus. Turn our eyes on him. Father, we thank you today that you are giving us a revelation of who we are in Christ, and all things are ours, and we have been blessed with every blessing in heavenly places. And we've been given back the lost dominion, and all things are subject to us and under our feet. Help that to become reality. We give you praise and glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus.